From the Nepsis Capital Management Studios, this is AM 1280, The Patriot, WWTC, Minneapolis, St. Paul, Intelligent Radio.
With SRN News, I'm Ron DeRockstra. Russian President Vladimir Putin has unexpectedly dismissed his chief of staff, Sergei Ivanov. And also, Louisiana Governor John Bel Edwards says his state's dealing with an unprecedented flooding after days of heavy rain, and the situation remains dangerous. Edwards says more rain's expected, and rivers are still rising. Louisiana National Guard Adjutant General Glenn Curtis says his agency has ramped up for this emergency and is planning to add even more resources.
Louisiana Guard has about 1,000 soldiers on mission here in the state of Louisiana. We have about 170 high water vehicles and about 20 boats and then 5 helicopters.
He says responders and boats and helicopters have pulled more than 1,000 people from their homes and cars, along with 100 pets. At least 2 deaths are blamed on the flooding. This is SRN News.
Larry Elder corrects some of the lies from the DNC.
That under Obama, the GDP has been 3.7%. In his dreams, the economy has grown at 3.7%. It's grown roughly 2%. Guess what the GDP growth was last quarter? 1.2%. That's pathetic. Pathetic.
The Larry Elder Show, afternoons at 5 on AM 1280. The Patriot, Intelligent Radio.
You could win $5,000 cash or a Ben-Hur prize pack in the Ben-Hur Dash or Cash sweepstakes. To register, visit AM1280ThePatriot.com. Here's a look at your forecast from the Benjamin Franklin Plumbing Weather Center. Mostly sunny this afternoon, high around 80. It's going to be comfortable this evening, low around 63. Tomorrow, about the same, mostly sunny, high around 80. And on Monday, high near 83.
This hour of the Northern Alliance Radio Network is brought to you by Thompson Building and Remodeling. With over 30 years of experience in home repair and remodeling, Thompson Building and Remodeling can ensure you have a quality job done right. From expert roofing, siding, and window installation to full additions and more. To see their work, visit online at thompsonpros.com. Thompson supports the Northern Alliance Radio Network to bring Patriot listeners a local voice in local and national politics. The Northern Alliance is on.
The Northern Alliance Radio Network with Mitch Berg.
Therefore, the burden of maintaining the peace falls on us. And to maintain that peace requires strength.
The Northern Alliance Radio Network on AM 1280, The Patriot.
Welcome back, Twin Cities and World. It's the wind beneath the right wing. The shining spot of red in the sea of dismal, dingy institutional blue. It's the Northern Alliance Radio Network, AM 1280. The Patriot, brought to you by Thompson Building and Remodeling. This week, every week, now and forever, the best builders and remodelers in the metro area and beyond. I've been recommending them for years and years and years, partly because that's why they pay us, but largely because it's the one of those sponsorships you just kind of get behind. He is the real deal. Jeff O'Meara is his name. He leads a crew of elite builders and remodelers, and they have never let one of my listeners down in all these years of trying. You'd think it had happened at least once. It has not. Find out for yourself. Go to thompsonpros.com to give Jeff O'Meara a call. Tell him Mitch Berg sent you. He'll know exactly who you mean. That's my name, Mitch Berg. My blog, shotinthedark.info. I'm also found on the web at True North. Look, truenorth.com is the address. It's the official center for center-right political thought in the Upper Midwest. I've been doing this show since 2004, along with my partner, Brad Carlson, heard every Sunday from 2 to 3 here on AM 1280, and King Banyan, who's heard every Saturday morning from 9 to 11 on our sister station, AM 1440, The Businessman. Together, we're the Northern Alliance Radio Network, who have been dominating Twin Cities weekend radio ruthlessly, but yet benignly, for well over a decade, going on a decade and a half now. Many have tried. All have failed to conquer us. Anyway, with us next is, just a little story behind this here. Now, normally, people call in and tell us that we need to have guests, we need to have authors, we need to have people on the broadcast. But rarely have we had one quite as persistent as the one who's been recommending that we bring our next guest on the broadcast here, to the point where For the first time in the 12-year history of the show, I finally cried uncle. And when I ran into our next guest at a Trump debate watching part, or a GOP debate watching party a few weeks ago, I said, please help us. Please come on the show so my producer can get some rest over in the studio there. And so with us, and by the way, she called to confirm that you were here. So apparently she's still on the job. With us, the extremely popular Mary Shapiro joins us. Mary, welcome to the broadcast.
Well, thank you, Mitch. And I'm really grateful to Pat because,
Well,
she's been badgering me to call you, too, and I just hadn't gotten around to it.
You know, fortune favors the bold, and persistence pays off, as I keep finding out in the job market every couple of years. So, yeah, it's all about the persistence. Well, it's great to have you on the broadcast here, Mary. Now, you were one of the winners in the primary this past week. Well, first of all, tell us, you're running in the Minnetonka area. What's your district?
We're 48A Minnetonka, which includes the northern part of Eden Prairie as well.
Okay, and the retiring incumbent is
Yvonne Seltzer, who is a Democrat.
Okay, Yvonne Seltzer, that'd be a great seat to flip back. So right now, let's talk about we'll talk about the race and the district in just a moment here. Let's talk about you first. Tell us a little bit about yourself, Mary Shapiro.
Okay, well, I taught in the Minneapolis Public Schools for 35 years, which is quite a challenge being a Republican.
Oh yeah.
I think in most of the buildings where I taught, I was probably one of two or three Republicans in the entire building.
I hear that from a lot of teachers. Yep.
I'm also a person who's involved in the arts quite a bit, especially theater and writing. And that's another place where I'm often a minority.
Yeah, I would imagine so. And we were talking about that off the air before the broadcast, and you said something that I don't believe has ever been uttered in this studio in the 13-year history of this broadcast, Fringe Festival. You were involved in the Fringe Festival this past week.
Oh, yes, I was. I don't see too many Republicans involved in the Fringe Festival, so I just had to do it. I had to do it.
I know, and it's interesting. As I keep, in fact, it's going to be the subject of a good part of the second half of this hour is the battle for the culture. In fact, I may push it back to next week because it deserves at least an hour on its own. But the battle for the culture is a constant thing. And there's huge swaths of culture that Republicans and conservatives have just given over, forfeited to the Democrats without a fight. And everything to do with art is one of them. And I say this as someone who I believe may have been the only conservative pundit in the Twin Cities punk rock scene in the 1980s. It's a stretch, but I may have been the only one. And so it gets lonely out there as a writer in Minneapolis, as a conservative Republican writer, I would suspect.
Well, I accidentally got into the punk rock scene because this was years ago, but I decided to dye my hair. It's pretty white and gray right now, and I wanted it black again. So I did. I put this henna stuff in, and I turned my hair bright blue.
And, oh, boy.
So that was my first year teaching.
Oh, boy. And,
so that was my first entree into the punk rock world.
And I'm sure a teacher walking with blue hair, all the Democrats said, one of us, solidarity.
No, the kids thought it was cool, so it was all right.
Well, that's right. Anyway, so and I got to figure, after 35 years?
35 years in Minneapolis.
Almost, wow.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, kind of like my dad, who's a Democrat teacher in North Dakota, probably a similar sort of fish out of water experience. What did that teach you about politics and the way politics plays into the lives of real people in the metro area?
Well, what I didn't like is a lot of the curriculum where there was so much propaganda in it, so much political correctness.
Oh, yeah.
A first grade group that I had, I decided I was going to take all their politically correct, boring readers and put them in a closet. And I took out a lot of traditional fairy tales.
Wow.
And which fairy tales are fantastic because they teach heroism, they teach courage, they
teach virtue. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, great stuff. I know Bill Bennett put out a children's book of fairy tales that illustrated the virtues that made America great. And I don't imagine that got much play in the Minneapolis public schools, but you're exactly right. Did that get you in any kind of trouble with the administration?
No, I played it pretty well. I bet. Sly.
You must have. Excellent. So you're coming way out of the political. Well, you're retired, so I guess you have a little bit of maneuvering room right now. But you seem like a fairly sane, well-adjusted person. What prompted you to run for state house?
Well, I had planned after retirement, what I was going to do is I was going to finish my novel. I was working on a collection of short stories, and that was my plan. And I just got really angry.
Oh,
angry
really?
At the culture, angry at the creeping socialism, and you know, there's something about me that I just don't like being told what to do.
Right.
I'm very oppositional sometimes, and I decided I got to do something about this. And so I decided that this was a good time to jump into the race, especially since a few of some very wise Republicans decided to run a Democrat as a Republican.
Oh, really?
I thought, whoa, this is a good time to jump in. That's
yeah.
my opportunity.
Absolutely. So I hear what you're saying about being angry about the culture. And I know the curriculum was, I used to, when my kids were in elementary school, by the way, just a little side story that I love to run by my teacher friends who are Republicans. I didn't used to give my kids an allowance. What I used to do was pay them $1 for every piece of indoctrination they brought home. And they did pretty well. They didn't miss the allowance. Like in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, they say, yeah, forget the allowance. I'm making a land office business here, bringing home indoctrination, because there is so much of it. And if you have your kids in the public schools, it sneaks by you sometimes. That just blows my mind. And this is where the culture is being defined for the future here. And that's scary stuff. So, yes, absolutely. We conservatives have to engage in the larger culture just outside of politics. So let's talk a little bit about your campaign here. What are you running on? And what are you putting out there in front of the voters?
Well, the reason given that they ran Chris Newcomer was that because she had a broader appeal, and because Minnetonka goes either way. We can go Democrat, we can go Republican.
Right.
That she would appeal to the more liberal end of the Minnetonka citizens. But
right.
I challenge that because I have so many circles of influence and acquaintance in education, in the arts world, in you know, the Christian population, the Jewish population, every place. And I, during the primary, I got several Democrats to vote for me too.
Really?
You know, yeah. In fact, I had Democrat colleagues promote me on Facebook.
Really?
Which was very interesting because they know my very conservative views.
Yeah. And it's got to be an interesting melange of cultures when you have someone with fairly conservative views, which we'll talk about in a moment here, trying to convince people who are not very conservative, to be blunt about it. How does that work for you? How do you do that? Because that's something an awful lot of conservatives need to learn. I mean, so many conservatives operate purely inside the echo chamber. And it's like, we're not going to get any more Republicans out of Benton County and out of Wilmer. There's just only so many of them. We got to reach across and convince some of them to come over here. How do you do that? What's your tack on that, Mary Shapiro?
Well, sometimes I frame it with the education issue, but it's also having been a teacher for so many years and going doorstep to doorstep while I was campaigning. I enjoy people,
yeah.
and I enjoy going to the doorsteps, and I enjoy talking to people, and I think they really pick up on that, and I think that's the clue. You know, we need to be more personable with people.
Oh yeah, well yeah, and not be afraid to get outside the echo chamber, which you certainly can't afford to be if you're a conservative teacher in a Minneapolis school district. So let's talk about your district. You're in 48A, which is, like you said, Minnetonka, a little sliver of northern Eden Prairie. It's purple, it's fair to say. It can go either way. It has gone the other way for quite some time. Now, Yvonne Seltzer is blue, as blue as they come in the Western Metro. What are you hearing from people? I mean, big part of campaigning is listening. What are you hearing from your potential constituents here, Mary?
Oh, people are totally fed up
with
politics, with everything. So people at the doorstep would tell me, "Well, I'm not even going to vote this year. I don't like what's going on. I don't like Trump. I don't like Clinton. I don't like, you know." But then I have to convince them. I say, "Well, those of us who are running for local offices, who are running for state offices, we are the ones that are going to have the most impact on your everyday life, you know, how many traffic jams are you going to encounter on your way to work, and
what gets taught in the schools?"
Exactly.
That's why I keep telling people it's the low level races that affect your day-to-day life. And while the federal races may affect lots of things for 20, 30 years down the line, whether you, how you get to work for the next couple of years, that all starts in St. Paul, absolutely. Well, we're talking with Mary Shapiro, who's running for the Minnesota House in District 48A. If you got any questions, comments, feedback, concerns, or just an attagirl, give us a call at 651-289-4488. We'll get to your calls when we come back on the Northern Alliance Radio Network, AM 1280, The Patriot.
Want to see what you'd look like if you had a flatter belly? Now's your chance, because for a limited time, we're giving away free trials of Somabiotics, the new discovery that flattens bloated bellies fast. But hurry and call now while we're still giving it away for free. 1-800-936-4789. Strict limit of one free trial per household. These free trials are reserved for anyone, male or female, who's looking for maximum belly flattening in minimum time. Somabiotics is scientifically formulated with natural ingredients to flatten bloated bellies fast by cleansing pounds of rotting food and toxic sludge from your body. It even combats periodic heartburn and acid reflux. So just think how much better you'll look and feel. Want to see what you'd look like with a flatter belly? Now's your chance. But hurry, call now for details while we're still giving these trials of Somabiotics away for free. 1-800-936-4789. That's 1-800-936-4789. If lines are busy, try again. 1-800-936-4789.
I have to get to sleep.
Tom had a stressful day, and now he can't shut down at bedtime.
Need sleep.
To fall asleep fast, millions of people turn to Unisom sleep gels. They're non-habit forming and quickly help you sleep soundly so you wake recharged. Tom? Unisom sleep gels. A stressful day deserves a restful night. Use as directed. Active ingredient diphenhydramine hydrochloride.
Something just happened that has explained why survival food is literally flying off the shelves and has sold out in many areas of the country. It caught me totally by surprise, and it involves FEMA. Revealing FEMA's plot could land me in hot water, but I think you deserve to know exactly what they're doing. I just created a free video presentation at FEMA8.com that exposes the truth. Be warned, it's really disturbing, because the fact is, FEMA must know something we don't. Go to FEMA8.com to see the number one item to hoard and why supplies of this critical item are so low or even completely sold out already at many stores across America. Watch the controversial video that thousands of other smart patriots have already seen in recent days. Go to FEMA8.com and discover the number one item most critical in a crisis. Go watch my video now at FEMA8.com before they force me to shut it down. Again, that's FEMA8.com.
I know you're excited for the new film, Ben-Hur, in theaters August 19th, but I know you'll be even more excited if you win $5,000 Ben-Hur Dash for Cash sweepstakes. One lucky winner will take the grand prize, and 25 others will win tickets to the movie and other special promotional items. Don't miss this epic story of revenge, redemption, and forgiveness from producers Roma Downey and Mark Burnett. You can buy tickets and enter to win the sweepstakes at BenHur-ForCash.com.
AM 1280, The Patriot, Northern Alliance Radio Network. 651-289-4488, the number to call. Join us, won't you please? You can also join us on Twitter at hashtag NARN. That's Northern Alliance Radio Network. Either way, you're directly connected to the broadcast here. Talking with Mary Shapiro, who just came through the primary to run in the District 48A for the Minnesota House of Representatives as a Republican, not as a Republican who has been a teacher for many years in the Minneapolis school district. Ergo, I suspect you've had to defend your beliefs more than a few times, or were you so good at flying in above and below the radar you were able to weave it all together without ever actually getting to any real blood spats with your colleagues? That was a big question.
No, I got along fairly well with my colleagues. I I think the first time that we were talking about an election, and I think I said I was going to vote for Romney, and my colleagues just looked at me like I had just confessed to being an axe murderer, you know.
There ends on that, yeah. Yeah, well, you're one up on me, because I don't think I've talked about politics in the office in 25 years myself. So the rest of the world isn't much better out there, and that's perhaps one of the signal lessons. I mean, we probably a lot of us have to be less withdrawing and then we are out there in public in the real world. As promised, we'll go to the phones in Minneapolis. Pat, welcome to the Northern Alliance Radio Network. You're on the air with Mary Shapiro.
Hi, Mary and Mitch. This is Pat, and I just want to say a couple of things about what I know about you is that you're a very good listener. Listen to all sides. I believe also you're quite deliberative, and very. You have a lot of integrity, which I think we need to get people in office that have that kind of a value system. You know, as conservatives. And the more people we get in and move the whole country that way, I think the better it will be, since we're getting to be more and more divided, as Mitch was talking about at the beginning, when you said they're moving more progressively in some of the Democratic races. Well, I think we need to be more conservative as well to kind of balance that off. But my question was this. I know that you had talked about it being a swing district. I understand it's pretty close, or has been pretty close. And wondered if Mary would give some of those statistics about how close it really is and how important it is to get people out. And secondly, how much money are the Democrats going to put into this race? And what does Mary think it's going to take to kind of match that, or if she has any idea of, you know, what people need to contribute?
Good question, Pat. Thanks for your call. I'll start with the money first. First of all, what's your campaign website?
But it's ShapiroForHouse.com.
ShapiroForHouse.com, which is where people can hopefully pony up a buck or two, especially if you live in District 48A. What kind of money is changing hands over there? I mean, since it's a purple district, there's got to be some serious coin floating around over there.
Well, all I know is that my opponent has raised $65,000.
Wow.
Already. And I don't know what other kinds of money is coming in. What I do need is a lot of volunteers.
Right.
think that is the key. If I have people who can get on the phone and go door knocking with me. And I think that's what got me over in the primaries, because I had so many dedicated people just who believed in the candidacy and worked for me, worked hard for me.
Well, I know there's a lot of wealthy DFLers in the western suburbs, although it's tied them over all that well in quite a few of the districts, like over in 32. 32 and 33 with our, of course, our good friend Cindy Pugh and Dave Osmek and Jerry Hertas. So not too far away from Minnetonka, but they must be nervous. I mean, they must really, really want to hold this seat. I mean, they wouldn't be pumping that kind of money into a district that they were super confident about.
Well, when Kirk Stensrud ran, I know that the National Party just pumped in, I don't know how much, it was like $1 million or more to get Yvonne Seltzer elected.
Right.
But Kurt only lost the I think it was like 41 votes or something like
that.
It
was well under a point. It was one of the bigger heartbreakers. So anybody who believes that your vote doesn't matter out there, it's this district is living proof that that's not true. 42 people could have flipped that district around here. We've had a few of those in Minnesota in recent years. And so when everyone would say, my vote doesn't matter. You know, we've had three votes, two that I can count of where a dozen votes either way would have made a very important swingy difference. Let's go to Eden Prairie. John, Big John, actually, to distinguish from all the other Johns on the line. Big John, welcome to the Northern Alliance Radio Network. You're on the air with Mary Shapiro.
Exactly. Listen, the thing is that I was one of Kirk's guys. Kirk was my guy. I am in Mary's district, but that's the good news. The bad news is I'm moving out of it on the 1st of September, so I won't be able to support her in the final. But the point is that the Minnesota Voters Alliance is using Kirk Stensrud's loss as the basis of their lawsuit, which is in the Supreme Court as we speak. And it is something that doesn't get a lot of play. And it is the situation where the Secretary of State is allowing felons and the same-day voter registration crowd to literally steal elections. And I believe, in my my heart of hearts that Kirk's election, second election, was stolen by ne'er-do-wells who bust in people who were from around here, if you will.
Or registered people who were not entitled to vote under Minnesota law. Excellent point, Big John. Thanks for your call. Comment on this, Mary Shapiro. Do you concern yourself with the lawsuits, or have you been keeping up with that?
Well, I did. I have read some of the articles dealing with it, and I so wish that we could have laws that would require people to show ID. I mean, that just is a no-brainer to me.
And a state bureaucracy that would enforce those laws, because we do have laws against fraudulent voting. It's just that they are also set up so that there is no way that they can ever be brought to anyone's attention, because you have to basically admit that you're committing wrongdoing to be prosecuted for wrongdoing.
Yeah.
Anyone who knows their Fifth Amendment rights can never possibly be brought up on any charges for it, because they're not going to be dumb enough to admit it anyway. So that's another hurdle that every Republican in Minnesota faces. And as speaking as a Republican from St. Paul, where Democrats win by margins of millions of votes. I'm being a little facetious, but where the vote manufacturing factory certainly makes everything a safe seat for Democrats, it's a daunting challenge. Anyway, let's talk about the strengths you have and what you need to put yourself over the top here in November. Obviously, the other side's pumping a lot of money into this race. They want to hold this seat. They put a lot of money into it in the first place, because this is one of those, if the Minnesota Voters Alliance is correct, this is a district where some of the legal bodies are buried, if you will. I mean, they lose this district, the jig could be up for them. And yet, if money was all it ever took, we'd have had a Governor Huffington in California at one point. Michael Huffington would have been governor of California 20 years ago. It didn't happen. So let's talk about how your campaign, the kind of campaign you're running, and the kind of help you might need out there on the streets of Minnetonka.
Well, it's definitely a grassroots campaign. It's I know I got a lot of support from my mail carrier, and I have a daughter with a disability. She has Down syndrome, and so she relies on Metro Mobility a lot. And so the bus drivers came to the door and said, "We're with you, Mary. We're with you." So I just think it's getting to know people, getting to every precinct, getting to know people. And just recruiting lots of volunteers who are dedicated and who will do it. And I think that's even much better than money, you know, to just have the people behind you and to work with you.
Absolutely. So this is, let's talk about, we've got about 2 minutes to go here, Mary Shapiro. And we can do this again before the election, because this would be an important race to flip. And anyone who can reach in the Minnetonka area to help flip that district back to you after that heartbreaking loss 2 years ago with Kurt Stensrud would be just a glorious thing to pull off here. So what can voters expect from you should you win this November? What would be your agenda when you go to St. Paul?
Well, my first concern is the people. That was my slogan, is people over politics. I don't care about, all the ego things involved. What I want to do is do the right thing for the people. I want to definitely cut down on wasteful spending. I also want to research some of the ridiculous regulations that are on small business. I've had friends and relatives who have gone out of business because of ridiculous regulations. And so that's one of the things I want to focus on. Also, of course, education. The less the federal government has to do with education, the better. I mean, local control of just about everything is more just than having the federal government get its little fingers into everything.
Heck, I'd like to get the state out of education for
that
matter. Yeah, absolutely.
Give power to the parents and the teachers and the students. You know,
the charter schools get one thing right. It's devolving power downward certainly brings a lot more accountability. And that's why I go back and forth with some of the enemies of the charter schools and say, oh, look at how many more. How many public schools do you think would survive if they had to follow the same rules and were as accountable as the charter schools are? At any rate, thanks for coming out, Mary Shapiro. Glad we could get you on the show. We'll do this again sometime. This would be absolutely the more fun flips to pull off here in this electoral cycle. So what's the website one more time?
It's shapiroforhouse.com. and you can volunteer on my website.
That would be ideal. I'll post the link at shotinthedark.info sometime around the end of the show here at 3 o'clock. We'll get that out there for people who need to get a little reminder. So thanks for coming out here, Mary Shapiro.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Best of luck this campaign. We'll be beating the bushes to turn people out. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Northern Alliance Radio Network, AM 1280 The Patriot. Our violent president, when we come back. When the law breaks in, how are you gonna go? Shut down on the pavement, or waiting in the pool. You can crush us, you can bruise us. A home, the biggest purchase you'll ever make in your life. Sounds overwhelming, but it does not have to be if you're working with the right team. My name is Jason Light with Envoy Mortgage. For over a decade, I've been helping people get the best financing as we will work together and we will get you fully approved by an underwriter far in advance. Now all you have to do is focus on finding the perfect home, all at no cost or obligation. So call me at 612-419-4517. NMLS ID 666 and individual NMLS ID 17256.
Are you sick and tired of being sick and tired? Does life need a 15-yard penalty for unnecessary roughness? If you want to be inspired, help in becoming all you can be, the time is now for Like It Matters Radio. Hi, this is Mr. Black, your radio coach and host. If good enough is no longer good enough, then join me Monday through Friday from 9 to 10 a.m. for your daily charge and focus.
Listen to Like It Matters every weekday morning at 9 on Wellness 1570.
Are you hiring? Do you know where to post your job to find the best candidates? Posting your job in one place isn't enough to find quality candidates. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites. And now you can. With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post your job to 100-plus job sites, including social media networks like Facebook and Twitter, all with a single click. Find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post once and watch your qualified candidates roll in to ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. No juggling emails or calls to your office. Quickly screen candidates, rate them, and hire the right person fast. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. And right now, listeners can try ZipRecruiter for free by going to ZipRecruiter.com/America. That's ZipRecruiter.com/America. One more time. To try it for free, go to ZipRecruiter.com/America.
You know, I'm not a genius about money. I love my credit cards, and they love me. I was using them as a source of income, and then I got behind in my payments, and creditors were calling. I figured I had a problem, and I didn't know how to deal with it. I heard about Trinity, so I called and talked to a counselor. In half an hour, we worked out a plan. Now I've got one easy monthly payment, a lower interest rate, and I'm getting out of debt.
If you're in an endless cycle of paying on credit card balances that never seem to go away, then get ready for a toll-free number that will put you on a path to financial recovery. Trinity will consolidate your accounts, put a stop to late fees and over-limit charges, reduce your interest, and possibly improve your credit score. You'll save thousands. If your debt has you down, we should talk. Call 1-800-990-6976. That's 1-800-990-6976. Call 1-800-990-6976.
AM 1280 The Patriot, Northern Alliance Radio Network, 651-289-4488. Join us, won't you please? So, I have been meaning for quite some time to spend an hour, maybe two, talking about the need that exists for conservatives to get involved in the culture around us. And by culture, I mean not so much the culture war, although that's part of it too. I mean the war over elements in our culture that are dividing and making us a worse group of people than we should be. Things like abortion, things like the education system becoming an indoctrination factory for young Democrats, things like the big red button issues that conservatives talk about constantly and fluently, the erosion of the culture of self-reliance, the erosion of the culture of achievement. Those are all important issues. And there are issues that conservatives need to win, but there's so many other issues, so many other elements of the battle to retain this culture. And it really, I was going to try and talk about it in the final half hour of the broadcast here, and honestly, it is just too big of a subject to fit into one lousy little half hour. And so, I don't know, one of these upcoming Saturdays, I'm going to spend an hour or two talking about not only why conservatives are losing the culture, notwithstanding the fact that we are winning, we do win elections. We do. We're not completely helpless electorally. We're not. But we do apparently need some help with the whole larger culture thing. I mean, even as we win elections, our culture is sliding to the left, and not just in the big ways, things like same-sex marriage and abortion and tolerance. You know, what's the most obnoxious one was the, I read a survey a while ago that said that while millennials are the most libertarian generation we've had in decades, they're also the most socialistic, which is a little bit like saying you're both simultaneously the most cat and the most dog person in the world. It makes no sense. It doesn't add up. It's almost an intellectual non sequitur being a libertarian socialist. It is a joke, really, except that people are that way. Millennials are largely libertarian socialists. In other words, they don't want people telling them what to do, but they want other people to pay for what they do. But there's so much more to it than just that. It translates into your job, for example. How many of your companies that you work for observe, have some sort of observance of Pride Week, or have some sort of observance of some, you name the social justice hot button issue that they that they spend time on? I mean, it's everywhere. And conservatives, tactfully, I think, like to keep politics out of every single nook and cranny of our lives. We like to keep politics in the political realm and leave our personal lives for personal stuff. Democrats have no such scruples. Progressives have no such objections. They have no problems with imposing progressivism, with the social justice war, with their values and beliefs on everything from your kid's little league team to your PTA meetings, to how your church runs, which is why so many mainstream Protestant denominations, and let's be honest, Catholic churches, parishes, are turning into social justice laboratories more than places for the worship of our Savior. These are areas where we, the conservatives, are losing the culture war. And I do want to spend a solid hour talking about that one of these days. But it's too big for a half hour. It just is. Let's talk about this. Donald Trump set off a fierce controversy earlier this week with remarks about the right to bear arms that were interpreted by many. This is from CNN, by the way. I'm quoting a CNN piece as a threat of violence against Hillary Clinton. Hillary wants to abolish, I'm quoting CNN here, essentially abolish the Second Amendment. By the way, if she gets to pick her judges, nothing you can do, folks. Although the Second Amendment people, maybe there is, I don't know, Trump said. He added, but I tell you what, that'll be a horrible day. And if Hillary gets to put her judges in right now, we're tied. Now, Trump's ambiguous comments alarmed some political observers as to whether he was threatening her life or calling for increased political activity. And let me expand on that last paragraph on CNN's parts. What the paragraph said was Trump's ambiguous comments alarmed some political observers. What it means is Trump's ambiguous comments alarmed ninnies who exist to try to alarm people and rack up cheap points for their candidate, who is in fact Hillary Clinton. I mean, you can expect the Clinton campaign to jump on this and say, hey, he's threatening violence. And I got to tell you something. I know I got some Trump fans in the audience here. As someone who has been identified with the Second Amendment movement, not that I own guns or anything, because they're scary, but as someone who has expended a certain amount of personal, political, and social capital for Second Amendment human rights, I got to say, joking about violence is the last thing you do if you're a prudent, intelligent Second Amendment activist. It's something you do. It's rude. It is off-putting. And it makes people regard you with suspicion. It's the kind of big talk that you hear from idiots at the end of the bar towards last call. It's not the kind of thing that we Second Amendment people need to do to win the battle. And by the way, this is one of very precious few battles where you and I, the conservatives, the people on the right side of society and history, have largely won the social battle. It's the wonks, the K Street people who are largely the ones carrying for and yeah, the bobbleheads with the ELCA hair running around in their dreamsicle shirts at their little anti-gun rallies are largely the ones who are carrying forth the gospel of gun control, because largely the good guys have mostly won this societal battle, even as conservatism has lost the battles on same-sex marriage and schools and immigration for now and many, many, many more. We've largely won the social battle on guns. We can't afford to be complacent. The battle will go on forever. We could still lose. But for now, we've largely won it because most Americans see gun owners as people just like them in a way that they don't with an awful lot of conservative issues. But I digress. Trump's remark, nothing you can do about folks, although the Second Amendment people, maybe there is, I don't know. Ninnies and alarmists, people, political opportunists took this, as they are wont to do, as a threat of violence against Hillary Clinton. And you could just see it coming. And those of us who are Second Amendment advocates who were taught to be, don't be inflammatory, be a regular mensch with your Second Amendment rights and with your hardware, let's be honest, and with the threat of violence that is inherent with the ability to deal out lethal force. You got to be judicious about this stuff. As my last carry permit instructor taught us, always wave with all five fingers when you're out on the road, because violence isn't something you talk about lightly when you're a carry permittee, when you're a gun owner, when you take the Second Amendment seriously. Now, real violence, of course, as I've shown on my blog over the years, is pretty much a monopoly of the lunatic left. Most mass shooters are either the ones who aren't just completely flat out mentally ill, as many of them are, tend towards the left politically, or let's be honest, Islamist, which is neither left nor right in the American sense. And let's not pretend it is. But Donald Trump made an ambiguous and, let's be honest, deeply ill-advised crack about the potential of Second Amendment supporters for violence. Let's talk about threats of violence for a moment here. They bring a knife, we bring a gun. Get in their faces. I don't want to quell anger. I think people are right to be angry. I'm angry. Hit back twice as hard. We talk to these folks so I know whose butt to kick. Getting into it with Republicans is going to be hand-to-hand combat. We see what we need, and it's time to fight for it. Latino voters need to punish your enemies. I'm itching for a fight. Get out there and fight for me. That's 11 direct quotes from President Barack Obama. Every one of them is at least as much a threat of violence as Donald Trump's wisecrack, deeply ill-advised wisecrack, I say, as a conservative and a Second Amendment human rights activist. But every one of those quotes was at least as obliquely a threat to violence as anything Donald Trump ever said. And a couple of them, they bring a knife, we bring a gun, hit back twice as hard. Why isn't that almost word for word what liberals were whining about Donald Trump saying at a rally? This is years earlier.
we talk to these folks so I know whose butt to kick? Let's come back to all of those. How about the war of war rhetoric that one side seems to notice of the other side, but not of their own? Let's talk about that when we come back on the Northern Alliance Radio Network, AM 1280 The Patriot. Go nowhere. Be right back.
AM 1280 The Patriot.
Hi, this is Terry Sanvold, CEO of Sanvold Financial Group and host of Money Talks here every weekend. Our company specializes in three areas. Number one is wealth management. Number two is retirement planning. And number three is proper insurance planning. Give us a call for no-cost financial review, 952-544-2837.
Registered representative of and securities offered through Questar Capital Corporation, QCC, member FINRA, SIPC. Advisory services offered through Questar Asset Management, QAM, a registered investment advisor. Sandville Financial Group is independent of QCC and QAM.
People who can afford a LASIK procedure sure are lucky. Imagine being able to throw away your contacts and glasses. Imagine waking up tomorrow with 20/20 vision. Too bad everyone can't afford LASIK. Well, guess what? There's a company that agrees with you. The LASIK Vision Institute is now offering dramatically low prices on high-quality LASIK to make it affordable for everyone. That means you get the latest FDA-approved LASIK technology for a fraction of what others charge. And if you call right now, we'll schedule a free appointment so you can discover if LASIK is right for you. Results may vary. Call 1-800-793-1963. Even better, if you're one of the first 100 callers, ask about an extra 20% discount off our already low-cost services. We've already performed over 1 million procedures. Let us help you. Discover how you can get the quality LASIK experience you deserve at a fraction of what others charge. For your free appointment, call 1-800-793-1963. 1-800-793-1963.
Learn to dance like a professional for half the regular price. American Classic Ballroom's world-class instructors will teach you how to glide across the floor with grace and elegance. You'll master the waltz, the tango, the foxtrot, and more. Through this special AM 1280 The Patriot offer, you get 20 private dance lessons from American Classic Ballroom, a $1,700 value for just $850. Call AM 1280 The Patriot now to take advantage of this special offer. 651-405-8800.
Get half off tutoring through AM 1280 The Patriot from Sylvan Learning Center of Eagan. Give your child the extra help they need to master math or reading. This Sylvan Learning Center program includes the assessment, registration, and 4 hours of tutoring in math or reading. Regular price $500, but through this special AM 1280 The Patriot offer, it's half price, just $250. Call the station today to get 4 hours of tutoring at Sylvan Learning Center of Eagan. 651-405-8800.
What does it mean to be a Christian woman in today's culture? How does your faith in Jesus Christ relate to the world around you? Sometimes to have faith can seem like an overwhelming task in today's busy and sometimes challenging landscape. That's why you need to visit iBelieve.com. iBelieve.com is a site designed for Christian women. iBelieve.com has blogs, videos, and even daily devotionals. Whether you're looking for advice, ideas for your church group, or just an uplifting message, visit iBelieve.com. That's iBelieve.com.
AM 1280 The Patriot, Northern Alliance Radio Network, 651-289-4488, the number to call. I can imagine right now over in the studios of AM 950, some bobblehead, Joshua Michael Smith, I don't know, is listening right now, as they always do, to keep track of what we're doing. And is writing a note right now and saying, hey, they're playing Street Fighting Man. Berg is calling for street violence. Headline for Monday. Assuming they have any local shows over there anymore, I don't know. Hey, they think the time is right for violent revolution. Gangs. Solution. What does that mean? using bands to commit violence. Violence in the streets, the Patriots calling for it. Help! And what are they going to say next? They're going to say, get down in the dirt! Yeah. We have all, this is something that is one of the nightmares I still have from elementary school. One kid yells something at another kid, the other kid picks a part out of it, twists it out of context, and makes it look like you're a horrible person for having said something you never said in the first place. I mean, you're picking things out of, by the way, it's happening with Jason Lewis too. Some of the opposition researchers that are out there are going back and finding things from his 20-odd year history on the radio and from his book that can be twisted out of context to indicate, what's this last one? There was last week a piece of literature went around saying that Jason Lewis said, yeah, if you want to own a slave, own a slave. Well, of course, it's completely out of context. It was an illustration of another larger point. It had nothing to do with approving of slavery. And yet, the Angie Craig campaign is running around, or at least its surrogates and lieutenants are running around telling people, oh, Jason Lewis says slavery's okay. Like the lying bobbleheads they are. And this is exactly the same sort of thing that you get, that is the lowest common denominator in American politics, let's be honest, where you have the likes of the American media taking Donald Trump's ill-advised, not bright, offhanded, but in the great scheme of things, utterly benign comment. Perhaps aggressive, but benign comment. But hey, Second Amendment people are going to, you know, take the matters into their own hands. How are they going to do that? Well, gosh, I suppose you could assume they're talking about violence. I'm assuming you could assume Donald Trump meant all those Second Amendment supporters are going to take up all those arms that they own and march on D.C. shooting everything in their path. You could assume it. Of course, you could go by the record and assume that what he's really talking about is continuing to do exactly what they, in other words, we, have always done, and that is organize politically, win the social battle, win the political battle, no guns drawn, no shots fired. Seeing the American left could stand to learn a little bit about, because while the left and the media, pardon the redundancy, continues to try and drum up this idea that underneath the facade of order on the American right, there is this wave of violence that's just dying to break out. It's always the left that resorts to violence. And when I say always, yeah, you can find someone on the right somewhere, at some meeting somewhere, in some bar somewhere, out in the middle of nowhere somewhere, someone who nobody ever heard of and whom no one will ever hear from again, actually getting violent with someone on the left. There was a fight at a Trump rally. Donald Trump says some things that could be interpreted as violence if you really, really, really want to interpret them that way. But on the other hand, you look at the objective record, which I do on my blog at shotinthedark.info, as I do in a series that I've been keeping up for the last 10 years now called Climate of Hate. If you go to my blog, you look on the right side at shotinthedark.info, and I actually will post a link to this on the blog as soon as this segment's over. What I do is I keep an ongoing record of violence and credible threats of violence by people on the left. Year in, year out, going back to, gosh, the 1990s, early 2000s at least. I mean, just looking at this past couple of months here, Bloomfield, New Jersey, 4 days ago, Trump opponent attacks Trump supporter with a crowbar. It's a classic case of Berg's seventh law. The media warned us about the Trump supporters committing violence throughout the entire election cycle. But so far, all of the serious violence, every bit of it, has come from the anti-Trump side.
What's another one? James Pierce, an obscure professor, called for liberals to arm themselves and kill every living thing at the NRA's headquarters, as well as their lobbyists around the country. He's an obscure college professor from the middle of nowhere. His Facebook page still carries his call to action. He claims it was a joke later. Of course, if you're a conservative who comes anywhere near talking about violence or something that could be twisted into a call for violence, like Sarah Palin putting crosshairs on a map as a metaphor for focus rather than as a metaphor for sniper attack, doesn't seem to count as an excuse. Michael Stephen Sanford, he's an illegal immigrant from the UK, allegedly, who tried to steal a policeman's gun to kill Donald Trump at a rally on June 18th. Omar Mateen, American-born son of Afghan immigrants who killed 49 people at a gay nightclub in June after pledging allegiance to ISIS. Registered Democrat, Hillary Clinton supporter. Huffington Post's Jason Benn says a violent response to Trump makes sense. The Detroit Free Press's editorial writer calls for, on June 7th, called for the murder of Michigan Republican legislators for supporting charter schools. Calling for murder. Throughout, in the newspaper, for crying out loud. All throughout the summer 2016. At Donald Trump rallies, mobs of thugs attacked Donald Trump supporters at events in San Jose and Albuquerque, and no doubt there will be more. Larry Russell Davison, March of 2016, registered Democrat preacher Larry Russell Dawson goes to Washington, to the Capitol, bellowing about raising the minimum wage as he waves a pistol, probably mentally ill, but he's a Democrat. Violence is part of their life. Roland Windsor last year, former Jimmy Carter staffer, says Republicans and conservatives are the enemy. They're expendable. They'll be targets in the revolution when it comes, calling for people to shoot conservatives. Now he's an insane old duffer, and he was a Carter administration staffer, which means nobody cares. But this is part of their culture, not ours. Call it for what it is. And remember, Berg's seventh law is immutable and universal. If they accuse us of it, they're covering for themselves. See you next week. God bless you all. God bless America. Stay alert.
Get that Rack Shack attack. Rack Shack barbecue. To do you right, we take time for a barbecue flavor that will blow your mind. Get that Rack Shack attack.
Join Gene Sullivan each week on Where You Live, where he takes on... Gene, who do you take on anyway?
Maniacal landlords, slippery renters, overbearing HOA boards, demanding homeowners. Oh, and the legislative lunacy brought on by local politicians wanting to fix everything for us.
It's a common sense perspective on the news and stories that affect you the most, right where you live. Join Gene Sullivan every Saturday morning at 10 a.m. on AM 1280, The Patriot.
The freedom of choice. It's one of our most cherished rights. But making good financial choices isn't easy. At Nepsis Capital Management, we understand the importance of making informed financial choices. That's why we believe in clarity. With Nepsis, you can gain the clarity needed to understand what you own and why you own it, and to make better choices. You can enjoy life knowing your investments are doing the best they can. Choosing clarity is easy. Tune into Investing for Success with Mark Pearson, president of Nepsis Capital, weekdays from 4 to 5 on Business 1440, or call Nepsis Capital at 952-746-2003 to set up a meeting. Make the most of your right to choose. Tune into Investing for Success, weekdays from 4 to 5 on Business 1440, and choose clarity. Or call us today at 952-746-2003. Or visit our website at nepsiscapital.com. That's 952-746-2003.
Geico presents Kathy, the candid real estate agent.
As you can see, this apartment has crown molding, and yes, that's a working fireplace. Can't you see yourself curling up with a good book? At least until a pipe bursts, and then you'll need to replace your brand new upholstered sofa. That thing will soak up water like a sponge.
It's hard to know all that comes with renting a home or apartment. That's why the Geico Insurance Agency makes getting covered for personal property loss and damage quick and easy. Visit geico.com and see how affordable renter's insurance can be.
Are you sure you know what you're doing?
Yeah, it's fine. I just watched an episode on how to remove a tree on that one website.
When it comes to pruning, removals, and stump grinding, call on Tree Trust Landscape Service. Trying to save a few bucks by maintaining your trees yourself could result in damage to you or your neighbor's property. Not to mention, it can be dangerous. So leave the task to the trusted professionals at Tree Trust Landscape Services. Find them online at treetrustls.com.